Hey everybody, I'm Vincent Racaniello.
And I'm Alan Dove.
And we are at the NEIDL, the National Emerging Infectious Diseases Laboratory, part of Boston University here in Boston. We've come back.
We were here 4 years ago.
Almost to the day.
Yes.
We recorded Threading the NEIDL, and today we're back to interview science writer David Quammen. Are you ready for this?
Absolutely. Let's go.
From the American Society for Microbiology, this is TWIB, This Week in Virology, episode 408, recorded on September 18th, 2016. And you're listening to the podcast all about viruses. So we recorded TWIB number 200 right here.
Right here.
This is a BSL-4 training laboratory, and you can see I should tell people, if you're listening, we also have a video for this episode, so you might want to check it out. We have the coiled red air hoses above us. We have a laminar flow hood behind us. We have some experimental animals here behind me.
It's a very well-behaved experimental animal.
It's kind of a homecoming. This is exactly where we recorded TWIB, but this time we have a special guest joining us. Perfect guest to be inside of a BSL-4. He's a science writer. He's the author of Spillover, Ebola, The Chimp in the River, and much, much more. He's also a contributing writer at National Geographic. It's my pleasure to welcome David Quammen.
It's great to be with you, Vincent and Alan.
Yeah,
nice to be here. We
have been wanting to talk to you a long time, and you're here to speak at the inaugural ceremony of the NEIDL.
Right, yeah.
Looking forward to that this afternoon.
I am too. I am too. And I'm tag teaming with Tony Fauci.
Pretty impressive.
What's not to like about that?
Yeah, it's great.
I'm flattered to be doing that.
What's the weather like in Montana?
The cold wind has started to blow. We've had snow in the mountains once. We had a fair bit of snow in some parts of the mountains. And the leaves are turning and the rain, chilly rain is coming. And so it's telling us that summer is over, but that's fine. We like that.
It's a little more accelerated than here in Boston. It's still a bit warm.
Yeah. Just the fact that I brought layers. Just thinking that, you know, if I'm gonna sit in Fenway Park tonight, I want to be warm. But
are you going to Fenway?
I'm
Park?
Going to Fenway tonight with Seth Nukin.
Wow. Oh. How about that? We had Seth on TWIB.
Yes.
That was by Skype, but
I wasn't on for that episode, but that was a good one.
That was good. And you know who the Red Sox are playing tonight, right?
Of course.
Okay. That's why you're going, I presume.
The Yankees, yeah, well.
Do you have any fan, are you a fan of either team?
Here's my history with Fenway Park. I grew up in Cincinnati. So, you know, we've been out of the picture for decades now, but in 75 and 76, I was glued to the TV watching Game 6 and then Game 7 in Fenway.
Oh, okay, great. So we know who you're rooting for.
It may rain tonight, though. Some clouds moving in.
Okay,
it's
I can take a rain jacket. I've got that.
So what we want to do today, we have about an hour and a quarter maximum. We want to talk to you about your upbringing, where you were raised and educated, how you got into writing. And we want to talk a little bit about your writing. I'm a big fan of your science books.
Thank you
And
very much.
We have lots of listeners who are thinking about careers in science writing. Of course, Alan Dove here.
I try to dissuade them at every turn, but you know how it is.
Don't quit your day job yet.
And we'll talk about viruses and emerging infections and so forth. So that should be interesting. So let's start at the beginning. Tell us, you know, where you were raised and educated.
Born and raised in Cincinnati, Jesuit High School, went off to Yale in 1966 because they had a great English department.
Major.
I knew I wanted to be a writer from early on. I just didn't know which kind of writer I was going to become.
Okay.
So I started my writing career as a fiction writer. Went to grad school in England, came back, had published one novel early 1970, and then I went to Montana in 1973. Thinking, okay, now I get to be a writer in Montana. And then I discovered, after my first book, how hard it is to stay published, even once you've been published, to continue publishing, to make a living as a fiction writer. And in the course of all that, I did the usual dues-paying jobs that a young writer does, tending bar, waiting table, working as a fishing guide, and in the meantime, discovered nonfiction. discovered imaginative, artful nonfiction writing, and realized, okay, this is what I want to do.
Yeah. Didn't Carl Zimmer go to Yale also?
Yes,
he did.
Yeah. We had Carl.
Another English major, another Yale English major. Who knows what that means?
You should become a science writer, I guess, because both of you have.
So Dixon would want us to ask, you were a fishing guide, fly fishing?
I was a fly fishing guide, yeah,
okay.
In Montana. Yeah.
I don't really.
I'm sort of a recovering fisherman. I was mad for fly fishing, tying flies, guiding for 10 or 15 years, 20 years maybe, when I first went to Montana. And then I drifted away from, I think I started whitewater kayaking, and that gave me my river fix, and I let the trout alone.
We have to give you Dixon Despommier, who is one of our co-hosts on TWIB, has just put together a website about trout fishing from a stream ecology viewpoint. He's put all his years of experience in fishing and photographs and writing, and I think you would like it. I'll send you the link.
Yeah.
It's called The Living River.
The Living River, okay. Yes, I'm very interested in aquatic entomology and all that stuff that lies underneath fly fishing.
I think you'll like this website. So, why Montana? Why did you go there of all places?
I had heard from a friend that there was a place called Missoula, Montana, where two or three rivers converged and there was snow in the mountains, even in September, and trout in the rivers. And I had just spent 6 years at ivy-draped institutions, very august ivy-draped institutions. And I was up to here with ivy-draped institutions.
Okay.
So I decided I'll go as far as I can get from ivy. And I rolled into Missoula, Montana in a Volkswagen bus filled with penguin paperbacks and a fly rod just over 43 years ago. I still sort of observe that anniversary. September 12th, 1973, I rolled into Montana, not knowing that I would spend a lifetime there. And I had never been in the state before that, but I just decided, okay, I'm moving to Montana.
And you moved there and your plan was to write.
My plan was to write, yeah.
Now you said that you found early on some good nonfiction works, and that inspired you.
Right. And I had read, I had done my graduate work and much of my undergraduate on Faulkner. I was obsessed with the novels of William Faulkner. And I was writing fiction and had read very little nonfiction, had taken very little biology academically. And so I got to Montana and I sort of turned a page and I became a non-degree grad student in zoology, learning about some of the science that I'd always been interested in. And I started reading nonfiction. I started reading early Stephen Jay Gould and Lewis Thomas and J.B.S. Haldane's essays and Lauren Isley and Robert Ardrey's African Genesis and a lot of other things. And I started seeing Freeman Dyson, Disturbing the Universe, some other very artful books of fact. And it was a revelation to me that factual writing could be artful, could be shapely, could be imaginative. And I decided, okay, this is what I want to do. And I started to realize, you know, I was a middle-class white male from a happy childhood in Ohio. The world didn't need me to be a novelist.
Not enough angst, right?
Not enough angst, no.
Yeah.
Not an underrepresented voice, right.
So I started, I discovered that nonfiction writing, particularly science writing, would give me an opportunity to explore the world, be nosy about other people's jobs, other people's work, travel, so that's what I've been doing.
So what was your first foray into nonfiction writing?
I started writing book reviews for the Christian Science Monitor. I started freelancing book reviews, and for some reason they trusted me to do science books. So Robert Oppenheimer's Letters, do you want to review it? Boy, do I want to review it. The Eighth Day of Creation, Horace Judson's great book on the founding of molecular biology. The Christian Science Monitor asked me to review it in 1978 when it had just come out. So I started doing things like that, and then I happened to fall into the opportunity of doing a column about natural science for Outside Magazine, writing an essay once a month for 400,000 backpackers, and hikers and outdoor adventurers. I did that for 15 years, and my saintly editors there really put no constraints on me except that this column each month, given that it was a natural science column called Natural Acts, it should at least contain each month a scientist or an animal or at least a tree. And I wrote about everything for 15 years.
Great.
And so that was sort of my transitional opportunity.
Okay. At some point you wrote a nonfiction book, right?
I did. My first full-length nonfiction book was The Song of the Dodo,
right,
published in 96, about island biogeography.
Right, which I think is tremendous and people love it.
Thank you.
And now, at some point though, you seem to get interested in viruses. What was the origin of that?
In 1999, I got a call from an editor at National Geographic. I had never worked for National Geographic, and this editor said, "We have a project. There's a fellow who is going to walk across the Congo Basin doing an ecological survey. He's going to walk 2,000 miles bushwhacking across the last remaining intact forests of the Congo Basin. And we want a series of articles about it. And we want you to be the writer. And your friend Nick Nichols, the photographer, is going to do the photographic side. Are you interested?" And I said, and the scientist's name is Mike Fay. And I had heard of Mike Fay. And I knew Nick Nichols and trusted him. And I said, no, because I was finishing a book about big predators. Thanks very much, that's interesting, but I can't do it, goodbye. And that was true. But it also turned out to be a very good negotiating move with National Geographic to say, thanks, but no. So they called me back and said, no, you don't understand. We really want you to be the writer on this for reasons known to them. And so I said yes to that. So to get back to your question, I would fly in to the Central Africa and then go by dugout canoe or bush plane or somehow and meet up with this guy, Mike Fay, who was on this walk 2,000 miles. Took him 456 days continuously being out there. I didn't walk all that with him, but I walked roughly 4 2-week sections. I'd come in, walk with him for 2 weeks, come to a resupply point. I'd go out, he'd keep walking. I'd go home and I'd write an article for National Geographic. At one point, we were walking through an area in northeastern Gabon called the Minkebi Forest Block. And on the edge of this forest block was the Avindo River and a little village on the Avindo called Mayabut number two, famous in the medical literature and in the epidemiological literature for an Ebola outbreak that took place in Mayabut Du in, I think it was 94, I think. So just 5-6 years before I got there. And I had read about that because I was interested in Ebola. And I had met the great Carl Johnson, and written a little bit about that. And I had read The Hot Zone and some other things, sort of entry level scary virus literature. And then I started to read the medical literature. And so we were walking through this forest block adjacent to where this famous Ebola outbreak had happened. And two of Mike Fay's forest crew, two of the Gabonese fellows who were helping him, carrying packs and building camps and things, they had been at Mayabut too during that outbreak. And sitting around the campfire with them one night, I started asking them, and they started telling me about what it's like when Ebola hits your village. Horrible. Friends and relatives dying. One fellow, Sofiano, lost 5 family members, I think. One of those was a niece who died in his arms. And they started telling me about this, what it had been like. And one of these fellows, the other one, Tony was his name, said, this is all in French, and he said, at one point, at the time of the outbreak, he and Sofiano had seen a pile of 13 dead gorillas nearby in the forest. And that phrase, is, and Faye was helping me with the French, my French is so-so, But I heard this phrase, a pile of 13 dead gorillas nearby in the forest. And it went into my notebook. And I had read just enough to know that gorillas and chimps are very susceptible to Ebola, mm-hmm. as are humans. And so this was my first impression of this phenomenon of diseases that are shared between species, mm-hmm. zoonotic diseases. And that's where I got interested.
Now, a little procedural question. I'm picturing you, you know, slogging through the forest. It's not easy what you're doing. You have
it's
to carry
easy.
Everything you need, all your food and supplies and everything.
Yeah, although these Gabonese guys were carrying, I mean,
they were carrying
it. It wasn't quite catered backpacking, but we were carrying, Faye and I were carrying light packs compared to what these other guys were carrying.
So are you constantly taking notes? Because I'm sure you can't be walking and taking notes, or do you wait for a pause and sit down, or do you write them down later in the evening?
No, my method when I'm with field biologists is that I have a notebook that's a moment-to-moment record, mm-hmm. And a ballpoint pen and a Ziploc bag. I get reporters' notebooks, and I cut them with a scissors so they will fit inside a Ziploc bag, like a one-quart Ziploc bag. I still buy the long, full-length reporters' notebooks, and I still cut them with a scissors so they'll fit in a Ziploc bag. So that's my field kit. A notebook, a ballpoint pen, and a Ziploc bag, because you're walking through the jungle and everything is getting wet all the time.
Yeah. So at night, when you're sitting around a campfire and, you know, people are confiding in you, are you sitting there furiously scribbling, or are you kind of...
No, and I've got a headlamp on.
Wow.
So this guy says 13 dead gorillas, and I have my headlamp, and I write 13 dead gorillas.
Right.
Well, and I guess that notebook.
If you're the guy who's always walking with the notebook, then it's not so intrusive when you're sitting at the campfire with the notebook, because you're just the guy with the notebook.
I'm the guy with the notebook, right. And Faye has a notebook, too, because he's gathering data.
Right.
So we walk through the jungle all day, and he and I and one point man with a machete lead out of camp, and we're an hour ahead of everybody else so that we don't make too much ruckus and scare the animals. And the guys behind us, the other, you know, 11 guys, gather up the camp and follow us through the forest, literally following our trail. And Faye walks 20 paces and stops and makes a note, you know, here's a pile of elephant dung. Puts his finger in it, is it fresh, semi-old, and puts a metric on it from 1 to 4, the elephant dung, and puts a metric on everything else. And so he's stopping every 20 feet and writing these things, and so I get to stop every 20 feet.
And
record my notes. There's Faye putting his finger into a pile of elephant dung.
And what does he do with this finger? Is he just...
Test the moisture.
Wipes it off and afterwards? And
he's
not carrying around...
He washes his hands before he eats, I assume.
Yes. We did a lot of washing at the end of the day. But he also... There was one point we came up to a pile of elephant dung, and he stops and he's looking at it, and I stop and I'm looking at it, and he's poking at it with his... pen and saying, see that? That's this kind of a seed. This is that kind of a seed. He's doing an examination, an analysis.
Is the elephant looking over your shoulder at this point?
Hopefully not.
Okay.
Hopefully not. But he's figuring out what the elephant had been eating. And we're both standing there in river sandals, in Teva sandals, you know, with our toes sticking out, because that's the way we traveled, shorts and sandals. And I can explain why if you want. But and then he says, oh, by the way, this is a good way to get footworms. Standing like you're standing in the elephant in sandals. Yeah, but that's after I've been there for 10 minutes. So
don't you get bitten left and right if you're wearing shorts and short sleeve shirts? And why are your toes out? Because you walk through a lot of water and your shoes.
Walk through a lot of water and mud and sand.
Okay.
And it's much easier if you're walking through a jungle, the Amazon or the Congo or whatever. Mm. It's much easier to keep your skin clean and dry than it is to keep any kind of clothing clean and dry. So I learned after the first 2 or 3 days, I essentially threw my shoes and my long pants into the campfire. I gave my shoes to one of the other guys, who was very glad to have them. And I shifted to river shorts and river sandals, and then we would walk. And mm-hmm. you come to a stream, and you go in waist deep, and you come out, and you keep walking. You dry off, or you dry off in front of the campfire at night. Mm-hmm.
So you had already been an outdoors person, right, from living in Montana?
Yes.
So this didn't bother you at all?
It didn't bother me much. I mean, Faye is tough. And so it was a challenge to keep up with him. He's one of the toughest biologists, field biologists, conservationists I know of in the world. He's great, he's wonderful, he's maniacal. And it was a challenge, but I got in the rhythm of it with him, and I had done other things that were physically difficult in the outdoors. Mm-hmm. Nothing exactly like this, but I adjusted fairly quickly.
So was there any point where maybe at night where it's completely dark and there's nothing around but animals, did you ever feel a bit scared?
Scared? No. I mean, there were moments that there was one night we were sitting at the campfire and a forest elephant came charging through the middle of the camp. It sounded like you were realizing that you had made your camp on some railroad tracks and the train was coming and you could hear it. And then whoosh, the train comes through and the sparks fly from the campfire and everybody says, "Are you okay? Are you intact? Is anybody, you know, stampeded into the coals?" And everybody was all right. And it's over before you know it. You don't have time. Generally, when dangerous things happen, you don't have time to get scared in advance.
Right. So this, much of this is familiar because I've just reread your books, and I think what you're describing is from Ebola, right? The book Ebola.
Well, it's in Spillover too. Ebola, right. The little book Ebola, is drawn mostly from Spillover.
Okay.
And so I tell part of this story.
Right.
There in the Ebola section of Spillover and in the book Ebola.
All right, so the Spillover was first, but what about the chimp and AIDS? Was that before Spillover?
The chimp in the river is also river. Drawn from Spillover.
It's
There's
drawn,
a long
okay.
chapter at the near the end of Spillover that is titled The Chimp in the River.
Got it.
And I think it was my British, can't remember if it was my British or my American publisher, who said, "Why don't you pull this out and we'll publish it as an independent book?
Mm-hmm.
Write a new introduction to it. Make it self-contained, and we'll publish it as a small book."
So a lot of your books are telling stories about your travels and the people you met and talked with and how you learned about virus outbreaks and so forth.
Yes, when I write about science, particularly if it's field science, if it's outdoor science, then I write about human characters, narrative, travel to a certain degree. Too.
Right.
Not just explaining the science, but telling the story of how the science is done.
Yeah. I think you often focus on the people as well, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I believe that, and I'll say that this afternoon in my talk. It's one of the cardinal principles. People want to read about people. So if you're writing about viruses, write about people who study viruses.
Mm-hmm. And that you think that is a great way to make it interesting for a wide
and I'm interested in readership. I'm interested in enticing people to turn the pages. I'm interested in entertainment as well as explaining science.
Mm-hmm. Right. So this first trip of yours where you followed Faye, did that lead directly to Spillover or was there more to that?
Well, 10 years passed. Maybe it wasn't quite 10 years. That was in 2000, I think. 99 or, no, that, I think that was in 99, July 14th or something like that, Bastille Day of 99, that moment with the 13 dead gorillas. And I filed that away. I wrote, one of the three stories that I wrote for National Geographic contained that, okay. contained a bit about Ebola. And then National Geographic came back to me about 6 years later, I'm just kind of remembering this mm-hmm. myself, came back to me 6 years later and said, "Would you," by this time I'm a contract writer for National Geographic and contributing writer, and they said, "Would you be perhaps interested in writing a story about zoonotic diseases?" Mm-hmm. I said, "You betcha." I would love to do that. I thought you'd never ask. And so I wrote a feature story for them on zoonotic diseases that was published, I think, in 2007 under the title Deadly Contact. And because it's National Geographic and because they support their writers and photographers so well, for that single magazine article, I was able to go to Southeast Asia with Billy Karish and to Cambodia and look for bird flu, and able to go to Australia with Raina Plowright and look for Hendra virus, and able to go to the Congo with Billy Karish again to try and tranquilize dart and blood sample gorillas to look for Ebola antibodies.
Mm-hmm.
So Congo, Cambodia, and Australia for one magazine feature, and then I wrote this piece, and then I said, this is more than a piece, this should be a book. Mm-hmm. So then I wrote a proposal and wrote the book.
So spillover is really a combination of all these experiences, the Ebola experiences. You talk a lot about AIDS and the origin of AIDS, all these other trips that you've taken.
It's all about zoonotic diseases, not purely but mainly viruses, because as we all know, viruses are the charismatic microfauna.
Of course. Yes. Of course, this week in virology.
Just to backing up a second, do you find that National Geographic still offers that level of support? I know they've changed owners and some stuff's gone on.
They do.
Okay.
And whatever you've heard about the changes in ownership, be reassured that National Geographic magazine is still National Geographic magazine. I just finished a special project for them, a single issue of the magazine entirely devoted to the Greater Yellowstone ecosystem. And they essentially gave me 2 years to research write that special issue.
There's nothing like it in the world, is there?
Not that I know of. Mm-hmm. I mean, The New Yorker is a great magazine, and they support their writers. I don't work for them, so I don't know at what level.
Send their writers to the Congo and Cambodia, and
probably not.
Yeah, I haven't seen articles with that level of backing.
Yeah, I mean, your books are unique in the sense that not only do they cover viruses, but you go to the places where people have looked for them and think they originated yourself, and you can describe all the stories around that.
That's another of my cardinal principles of science writing. Point number 6 or point number 8 or whatever. Go there.
Yeah.
Simply go there.
Right.
If you can. If you can somehow scrape up the money to buy a plane ticket to the Congo. Mm-hmm. Or if you're, when I was writing The Chimp in the River about the ecological origins of AIDS, I saw a journal paper published with a little map in it, and the journal paper was about the discovery of which chimpanzee population contained the SIV that most closely matched HIV-1 group M, which is the pandemic strain. And I think it was a paper by Beatrice Hahn. Mm-hmm. I can't remember who the first author was, should remember, Brandon Keel, I think. Mm-hmm. And here was this paper saying, we found the origins of the AIDS pandemic. It's chimpanzees in the southeastern corner of Cameroon, this little square on the map. And I looked at that little square, the paper was in Science, I think. And I looked at it and I said, hell, I've been there. I walked through there with Faye. Not through southeastern Cameroon, but just up the river over here in this corner of the little square. And so I thought, well, I got to go back. If I'm going to write about this.
Got to go meet those chimps.
Got to go meet those chimps. Got to go talk to some people. Got to go see what's happening with chimps in that area. The cradle of the AIDS pandemic. Little triangle of jungle on the upper Ovindo River. So I went there.
And in fact, if you read the AIDS part of Spillover, in parts, it's like a novel, right? When you're following the Voyager on his travels.
There is a section of it, right. There is a section of this AIDS chapter where I use some of the techniques of fiction. Mm-hmm. But I am very clear in telling the reader, okay, now we're going to hypothesize. Now I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to tell sort of a parable of how this virus may have gotten down the river from this southeastern corner of Cameroon, down the Ngoko River to the upper Ovindo, down the Ovindo River to the main stem Congo, to the capital cities of colonial Africa at that time, Brazzaville, Republic of Congo, and Leopoldville, now Kinshasa, the Democratic Republic of the Congo.
So this uses your skills in both fiction and nonfiction writing, right?
It did. I created this hypothetical character, the Voyager, this guy who becomes HIV positive. He's not the number one, he's not patient zero, and neither was Gaetan Duga, as we know, although he took the rap for being, quote, patient zero. So this guy, he becomes infected, I hypothesize him, and I tell a hypothetical story of how he might have carried the virus to one of those capital cities, which was the fatal event. Mm-hmm. Get somebody bringing that virus into a dense population center, dense meaning in those days, you know, a labor camp of 10,000 men you know, professional women.
It's a great story, and it was striking to me. You must have had a lot of fun writing it because it involves elephant tusks and a little bit of conflict and so forth. So you obviously had a lot of fun, and it's a great contrast. You must have read The Origin of AIDS by Jacques Pepin.
Yes.
Which is a really dry, straightforward telling of the facts.
And a very valuable book.
It's a great book, which I enjoy very much. You know, he didn't wind any stories. He said, well, there was probably a cut hunter and he must have gone to a big city and spread the book. But you took that and made it appealing to more people.
And I took the work of Beatrice Hahn, the work of Martine Peters, the work of a number of other people, the work of Bob Gallo and Luc Montagnier, and Jacques Pepin's fine book on the origins of AIDS, which came out, as I recall, just before I was finishing writing Spillover. And my job was to make that page-turner material.
Right.
How would Faulkner tell this story?
How would Faulkner tell this story? Yes, in a way. Although, you don't want to imitate Faulkner too much.
Right.
Yeah, that I highly recommend that. And in connection with that whole story, you visited towns where meat was being sold, bushmeat.
Mm-hmm. Bushmeat, yeah.
And you make the observation that there's still a lot of chimp meat being sold behind the scenes, right?
Yes.
Is that going on still today?
Still going on. I mean, and we should say that, you know, bushmeat is a real problem. The wildlife of Africa, much of it carrying viruses, is the protein that a lot of people, some people who desperately need protein rely on, and other people consider a food of preference.
Yeah, yeah.
But when we call it bushmeat, it carries sort of a negative onus. You know, when Africans do it, we call it bushmeat. If a guy in Montana does it, we call it game.
Right. Yes.
Yes.
And what's the difference there? Well, in Montana, nobody hunts non-human primates. There aren't any. But essentially, the moral valence, as far as I'm concerned, is the same. Mm-hmm. So, having stipulated that, yes, bushmeat is a problem, and it's still being dealt in great quantities in Central Africa and other parts of Africa, and it comes from the forests, and it's bad for the population status of these animals, some of them, and it's devastatingly bad epidemiologically.
Sure. I mean, I think of it as more chances for other spillovers of SIV into people, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, we know that there have been, what's the number, 12 independent spillovers of different SIVs, either from monkeys or from
that we know
apes,
of.
That we know of, 12 that we know of, into humans. And of those 12, one is the pandemic strain that's killed 36 million people.
Right.
And the other 11, we mainly dodged the bullet. But as this goes on, it offers more opportunity.
So it also is destroying the populations of chimps and gorillas. Do you have some sense of how many of these animals are left?
Well, nobody knows exactly. Yeah, I mean, nobody knows even roughly. There are guesstimates that can be made, but you know, wild animals in the forest are hard to count. I think the guesses are for chimpanzees, the guesses are maybe in the low hundreds of thousands.
Wow.
And the Western gorilla, less than that. I'm hesitant even to stab at
sure,
a number,
sure,
but
sure.
But tens, hundreds of thousands, whereas there are 7 billion of us. So if a virus makes the leap from a chimpanzee into a human,
huge advantage.
It has won the sweepstakes.
Yes.
It has won the sweepstakes because the chimp, God help us, the chimp is on the decline and we are not. So the virus that makes that leap has achieved a great Darwinian success.
Right.
And like HIV-1M.
So in fact, as you point out in your book, SIV is pathogenic for chimps and Ebola is probably pathogenic for gorillas, and that's contributing to their decline as well.
Yeah, and Ebola is pathogenic for chimps too.
Yep.
And we didn't know that SIV is apparently pathogenic to chimps until Beatrice Hahn enlisted the help of Jane Goodall.
Right.
And that's an interesting story,
collaboration.
Too. Yes. Collaboration. Have you ever had Beatrice on?
Yes. I have had, I did a one-on-one interview with Beatrice for ASM, who's producing this show. And we talked about that as well. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting. In the end, you know, I asked her what's the most important thing she's done, and she said, I think it's bringing awareness of the fact that chimps are not just fuzzy laboratory animals, but we have to respect them, which is very interesting for a scientist. Right?
Yes, yeah.
But she's a great interview. Yeah. So let me ask you another question about travel. If you were going to write a book on Zika, where would you go?
I suppose I'd go to Florida and Brazil.
Okay.
And to Uganda.
Yeah, I bet you'd go to the Zika forest, right?
I would absolutely go to the Zika forest, because that's part of the story.
Yeah.
And another thing that I think is a principle of this, and I'll talk about it this afternoon, is remembering that everything comes from somewhere. Mm-hmm. Everything comes from somewhere. Every disease pathogen comes from somewhere. Most of them come from wildlife,
right,
getting to us, because most are zoonotic. And that includes Zika. And to know, for people to know, that Zika virus that everybody is concerned about this year, it's this year's virus of concern. Next year will be something else.
Yes.
Yeah. Sure.
Zika, why is it called Zika? Well, because it comes from the Zika forest. What's the Zika forest? Well, it's this forest in Uganda where the Rockefeller Foundation in 1947 was putting Asian monkeys in cages into trees to monitor for yellow fever. I think it was yellow fever, as I recall.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
And they pulled one of these monkeys down and they found a virus that was not the yellow fever virus. What is it? Well, let's call it Zika. And then everybody forgot about it for
many years. You're not planning to do a Zika book, are you? Because I'd love you to do it. I'd love to read it.
I'm busy with another project right now. And I would do a Zika book. I've got to stick with what I'm on right now.
I understand, but
I've written a couple of Zika op-eds and things like that, and other people are covering Zika.
What are you working on right now?
I'm working on a book about the idea of the tree of life as it has been radically challenged by discoveries from gene sequencing in the last 30 years. So I say sometimes that I'm working on the lighter side of molecular phylogenetics.
Okay. I wanted to just give you a little more praise here, because I think you do some things really, really well. On TWIV, we get very upset by the hyping of science by the journalists who write on a daily basis, who need to have news and who need to get clicks on their web pages. You seem to avoid that hype. And here are two points I found in your books. For example, the reservoir of Ebola, which you say correctly, we don't really know what it is, but you know, the press over and over says it's a bat somewhere.
Right.
And we're not really sure, but you said very clearly, and I think that's awesome. You also write, when you're talking about the Ebola outbreak, there's a science paper entitled "Ebola Outbreak Killed 5,000 Gorillas," and you call it a forceful but overconfident headline. And these are two examples where I think you have the right amount of skepticism. Where does that come from?
First of all, thank you. I try hard for that because I depend on access to scientists. And if your reputation for accuracy stinks, it'll get around.
Yeah.
And that will impede your access.
Right.
So you got to keep faith with your sources. You got to think about the fact, another for me cardinal principle, is that when you're writing about science, you need to dial down precision and never compromise accuracy. And if you don't understand the difference between precision and accuracy, you should get in another line of work.
Mm-hmm.
Scientists demand and love and wallow in precision. And that's good. That's part of the job.
Right.
And as well as, of course, accuracy. But to understand that you can dial down precision, almost like you're two knobs on a mix,
right,
an audio mix or something, you dial down precision, but make sure that you never lose that 99-100% accuracy, is what it's about.
Yeah. Well, I in particular appreciate it, because we're very sensitive to this. The daily science press is very guilty of overhype, as dialing
particularly with the things going on in the industry now. Yes. People are getting more and more desperate for clicks or whatever the latest metric is.
One of the current ones with Zika is that the virus mutated in its travels from Africa to Asia and Brazil, and now it's more virulent for people. That's another thing that you understand, that virulence is not necessarily a good property for a virus. It's not something that may be selected for it. This is perfect. That's what we say all the time, but few people seem to understand.
Well, you know, at the base of this is Darwin. Mm-hmm. And I know that, you know, you can graduate from a medical school in the U.S. and probably most parts of the world and never have read Darwin.
Yep.
You can probably get a PhD in virology and never have read On the Origin of Species.
It was not required reading at any point in my education.
Yeah.
I read it,
but
only because I wanted to.
Yeah.
Entirely voluntary.
Yeah. But there it is at the base of all this, understanding how and how evolution works, what natural selection is about. And yes, the picture is much more complicated than that, but Darwin, it's amazing how right Darwin has been for 150 years, how right he has stayed.
Absolutely, absolutely. So you mentioned that you talk a lot with scientists to understand what they're doing. How about the primary literature? Do you read papers? You mentioned you didn't have a science training.
Right.
It must be hard, right?
But I've been doing it now for 35 years. I read a ton of journal papers. I read journal papers all the time.
And you understand them for the most part?
No. Not the first time through.
Okay.
And then I read it again. And now I go from 25% comprehension maybe to 40% comprehension. And I read it again, and I keep reading it.
You think scientists are any different?
I don't know.
We did a segment that I think we broke out as a little separate 20 or 30 minute piece
how
to read a paper. And we talked about how we read papers, and one of the things that came up was none of us pick up a paper and breeze through it and get it immediately. It's packed information, and you have to unpack all of that.
Well, I'm glad to hear that.
Yes.
Do you ever, in the course of reading a paper, just can't get through something and then call the author or call someone who might know it and ask them to explain it?
I don't do that much. I might do that some. I might email if I have a trusted contact.
Yeah.
I might email somebody like Ford Doolittle, who is much involved with molecular phylogenetics, Ford Doolittle in Halifax, and who's been one of my very helpful sources and is one of my characters in this. Mm-hmm. And I might say, you know, Carl Woese said something. Mm-hmm. I know this is bacteriology now. But,
it's okay.
But it's allowed.
Carl Woese is a central character of this book project. Fascinating, fascinating guy. He's dead. I never met him. Mm. I might email Ford Doolittle and say, what did Woese mean by this?
Exactly. Good. So on TWIV, we often mostly discuss papers. And, you know, we have three or four or five people on the Skype. And sometimes we'll say, I don't understand this figure.
Right.
And someone among us can, here's what that means. And here's how they did it. So group analysis like that is great for science.
Yeah.
So you have people who are willing to say, I don't know, right? Not every scientist is willing to do that.
Yeah, right.
That can be
a
problem.
But I don't have that kind of, I'm not part of a university. I'm not part of a lab. I'm just this guy sitting in a room in Bozeman, Montana.
You know, you can always call us. We'll be happy to talk.
I will. Vincent, what does this mean? Alan.
And he'll say, we'll say we don't get it either.
But I'm an autodidact. You know, this is, as I said, I have very little academic training in any of this stuff, but I've learned it. It's been a journalistic beat for me for 35 years. But the fact that I'm solitary, I'm out there in Montana, I'm reading the literature, I'm not sitting in classrooms, means that I might learn a lot of this stuff, but you can find me out because I don't necessarily know how to pronounce things.
Yes.
Because I'm reading things like, how do you pronounce this?
Yeah. So here are a couple of quotes I highlighted from some of your book, which I love. Good data are where you find them, not where you look. This is perfect.
Yes.
You wrote that, did you know?
Did I?
Yes.
Okay.
Sometimes you find much more than you're looking for. And I always use this as a reason not to regulate science, because you never know what you're going to find. Then this one is pretty funny. This had to do with the Reston Ebola outbreak in Virginia. 10 employees who had helped unload and handle the monkeys were also screened for infection, and they also tested negative, but none of them were euthanized. And I think you make this contrast often between people and lab animals.
Yeah, that's what, in writing about viruses, that's what passes for a joke.
Yes.
I got it. I laughed.
I'm glad. I
laughed
that.
To myself. And finally, this one I mentioned before, sheer lethality may be irrelevant to the virus's reproductive success and long-term survival. And this is perfect, and not everybody gets this, so I'm happy to point out that, yeah, you get it.
Yeah. Dead people don't get on the subway and cough on anybody.
Nope. Right. So you love viruses, clearly. Why not bacteria? They're pretty interesting, a lot of them.
I'm in the thick of it right now.
You are.
Carl Woese.
Okay.
And the archaea.
Right.
Yeah, this is the last 3 years has been my crash course in bacteriology and molecular phylogenetics, as I said.
So there are zoonotic bacterial infections as well. There's spillovers too. So mm-hmm. Maybe not one every year, but
no, and not generally as scary, mysterious, or devastating as the worst of the viral spillovers. But mm-hmm. And I write about one of those in at least one. In Spillover, I've got a section devoted to Q fever.
Right.
Which is, a spirochete, right? Caused by a spirochete,
I think that's right.
Mm-hmm.
And interesting case. And I wanted to include something that was non-viral. So here's a bacterial pathogen that...
Coxiella burnetti.
Yeah, okay. Is that a rickettsia?
See, this is what we do on
Twitter. It's a rickettsia.
We look
things up, yes.
We're not sure.
It's
because
crucial to have internet
access.
Vincent
is Googling
episode.
Right now.
Otherwise, people will will write.
So I stand corrected. I think it's a rickettsial agent.
Coxiella, let's see. I think you may be right about that.
Likewise, Lyme disease.
All right, anyway, keep talking. I'll look it up.
And Lyme disease is another good spillover example.
Yep. Interesting story.
So now, in terms of the way the conversation has gone around emerging infectious diseases, I mean, certainly since 2001, we've had this mushrooming biodefense industry, and there's a lot more attention to coming up with countermeasures or some kind of response. But there's a lot less attention, it seems, to the sorts of things that lead us to encounter these agents in the first place, which is endlessly expanding tendrils of civilization into forests and mm-hmm. increasing our, fragmentation of ecosystems. Obviously, there are huge economic pressures behind that.
Mm-hmm.
But is there any way to move that focus, or is it just this is something that's going to be part of our reality that we're going to keep?
Well, I
going
think,
to keep poking this with a stick.
Yeah, there are, there are researchers, there are scientists out there who are working on the field end of this. EcoHealth Alliance mm-hmm. has people in the field. Nathan Wolf's group has some people in the field who are studying this on the spillover end, studying the different opportunities that viruses, in particular, get into people.
Right.
And it's all about opportunity, and opportunity comes from interactions generally with wildlife and comes from disrupting ecosystems.
Right.
So you get disruption and then opportunity, and then a bug takes hold and maybe it evolves and it adapts particularly well to humans for transmission, and then it gets on an airplane and pretty soon you've got a pandemic.
Right.
But the beginning of that is that one spillover, that opportunity. The West African Ebola event. We can't call it an outbreak. It was, as far as West Africa was concerned, it was an epidemic. 28,000 cases, of which all but one were human-to-human transmission.
Right.
And one of those was the spillover from a reservoir host, some species of wildlife, probably into that little boy in the village of Meliandu in southeastern Guinea.
Right.
So, yeah, you've got to deal with the human-to-human transmission. You've got to deal with all this epidemic emergency, but you have to prevent that one spillover too.
Right.
And people know that. USAID, as part of its Emerging Pandemic Threats grant initiative, I think supports research mm-hmm. on prevention.
Mm-hmm.
Predict, prevent, I can't remember what the other cardinal points are in that initiative. So I think it's being done. Doesn't get as much attention, but it gets attention from me. It's great if you're a science writer, a storyteller,
right?
Because every new emerging disease is a mystery story. So you get to write mystery stories. You get to write about the detectives who are out there.
Right.
And so Coxiella was originally thought to be a rickettsia, similar, very similar, but eventually found to be different enough so it was classified separately.
Oh, okay.
But it's not a spirochete. Okay, folks, it's not a spirochete.
It's not a spirochete.
So okay.
Rickettsia. You spirochetologists, don't write in to Vincent and Alan complain.
We've been educated now.
Many people will stop the recording at that point, write their email, send it, and then often this happens, then after they listen, they go, oops, sorry, forget that last email. So lots of science writers do this for a living, as you do. Is there a place, so you communicate science in a way, as you make it exciting, you tell stories, but is there a place for scientists to communicate science? Or do you think we're too dry to do that?
Well, you're dry for very good reasons. I mean,
hey, you can't say that. You're agreeing that
You're not dry. You, Vincent, and Alan, no, you're not dry. You're doing this. This is not dry. This is twill.
It's because you're here, right?
This is I know. It's never dry. It's never dry on twill.
That's a good tagline.
It's never dry on twill. That's good.
But scientists, when they write journal papers for one another, some people say, oh, you know, it's technical writing and they're writing in code. You know, no, it's a very, very efficient way of delivering information to one another. And it's not part of the job description of a scientist. It is part of your job descriptions as broadcasters, as science educators, you know, to explain it to the general public. But if you're a scientist, then, I mean, maybe you want to do it, but you shouldn't feel like you need to do it. You shouldn't beat yourself up because you don't have the skills to do it. Again, that's part of my job here today, I guess, at this NEIDL conference. I when they invited me, I said, what can I tell these folks? These folks are my sources and my inspiration. Paul Dupre, I said, why are you, am I pronouncing that right, Paul? Yeah. Why are you inviting me, for the love of God? And he and Jerry Cush and Ron Corley said, well, because you're going to tell us how to tell the story to the general public.
That's right. And we all know they invited you so we could do a TWIV.
Yes.
I appreciate that.
But of course, you're going to, I think it's important for you to tell the scientists and whoever else goes to this meeting how to make science interesting.
Yeah.
It's really important because, science. People distrust science nowadays to a great deal. They don't want their vaccines. They don't believe in climate change. And we have to all combat that, and you're part of it.
Right.
And I think while it's not part of the job description for scientists to be science communicators, there is a good chance at some point that the camera will suddenly turn to them. And hopefully, what you're going to tell them and you know, coming across this information, it will help them be a little more articulate and understand who they're talking to when that happens.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we hope. You know what? Another thing I think it's worth saying, and I'm going to say it again this afternoon, when scientists wonder how can we communicate our work better to the general public, one of the answers to that is what I sometimes call choosing your Boswell. Letting Boswell in. Scientists get calls from media. Mm-hmm. And it involves choosing the right Boswell and being critical. So when you're a scientist, you hear from journalists, you hear from science writers, and it's valuable to you to work with them, to say yes to them, to cooperate and let them tell your story.
To answer their own phone calls.
Yeah, but you don't want to waste your time, and you don't want to encourage the wrong people, because if you get some ding-a-ling who calls you and says, you know, I'm writing this newspaper story and it's going to run tomorrow morning, you might talk to that person for 15 minutes and that person will get three things wrong and misquote you, and that story will run the next day. I don't want to beat up, you know, my colleagues in the journalistic profession, but if you're writing about science, you need to be careful of accuracy. You need to double check. You need to get it right. And not everybody does that. So scientists are entitled to say, I'll talk to a journalist, but I'm going to be kind of choosy. I want a journalist who cares about getting it right. And I will invest some time and some trust in that person, mm-hmm. and then I will blow off these other people.
Yeah. So among the, earlier you mentioned some of the books you, science books you read, and some of those were scientists who wrote those books. And I think someone like Lewis Thomas wrote great science books. So scientists can do that.
Yes, some of them, some of them.
You have some favorites besides the ones you mentioned?
Yes, scientists who write well. I liked Ernst Mayr quite a bit. Mm-hmm. The Growth of Biological Thought, which is, you know, a thick tome, 800-page history of biology, but he could write. He was a good writer. And one of the things that helped him control the history of his profession is that he wrote the history. Mm-hmm. Who else? My mind always goes blank when somebody says...
That's not a good sign.
No. I mean, I have science colleagues, too, who... I think very highly of James Glick, Michael Spector, mm-hmm. you know, Carl, we talked about Carl Zimmer, Ed mm-hmm. Yong, mm-hmm. some of my colleagues there, I think very highly of David Dobbs, a number of others. In terms of books, I mentioned James Glick. Is it Jonathan Weiner? I'm spacing the first name of the fellow who wrote Beak of the Finch.
And yeah, he's a colleague of mine at Columbia.
Jonathan.
He's in the J School.
Yeah, okay.
Jonathan Weiner, yeah.
Yeah, his book, Time, Love, Memory, mm-hmm. I think is even better than the Beak of the Finch. Interesting book.
I teach a class, he teaches a class on science writing, and I give a lecture on viruses in it, and I want to get him on TWIV, he'd be great.
Yeah.
His book is really good. Yeah. It's really interesting.
So there's some wonderful stuff out there.
So we're getting towards the end now. We're going to let you go. I just have a few more things I want to ask you. Do you have a favorite travel story that you could tell us?
I mean, besides 13 dead gorillas?
Yes. That was a pretty good one. Good, yes.
Too many.
Too many. I mean, charging elephants. And Komodo
too.
Dragons. I had some interesting Komodo dragon mm-hmm. encounters when I was researching the Song of the Dodo, walking in the backcountry of the island of Komodo with a backcountry ranger from the Indonesian Park Service and with my translator and traveling companion, Nyoman, the Balinese tailor. Three of us were in the backcountry of Komodo walking around, and Komodos are lurk and lurch predators. Mm-hmm. They hide and then they're really fast over the first 20 feet. That's how they get their prey, Komodo dragons. And we're walking around, and at one point we walked past a bush, and there was this explosion of you know, ruckus, and a full-grown Komodo dragon, about 10 feet long, maybe 200 pounds, comes busting out of the shrubbery behind us, like 20 feet behind us, and we turn around, and he sort of, I don't know if he actually looked at us first, but he could either attack us, sort of taking us, you know, behind the kneecaps, or split. And he split, and he ran off, stampeding through the shrubbery and the grass, and there are these big cliffs in Komodo, these mm-hmm. big, you know, I think lava cliffs. And I swear to God, this Komodo dragon ran up about a six-story vertical cliff, just like a gecko going up mm-hmm. a hotel room wall, and went over the top and was gone. And we, the three of us just looked at each other and said, oh, duh. That turned out okay.
Yeah, well, he probably wasn't interested in humans, right? Do you think he would have seen many humans? Maybe.
Yeah, they attack humans. They would, there are people who get killed by Komodo dragons.
You did outnumber him.
Outnumbered him. I think we were lucky. We were lucky.
I bet you have lots of stories for that you didn't write about, right?
I've got versions of that. With polar bear, with grizzly bear, with saltwater crocodile, with Asiatic lion. The less dramatic versions with the Amur tiger.
It'd be great campfire stories.
Yeah.
That's what I try to write. I try to write campfire stories with science in them.
Are you staying for this whole meeting?
No, I'm gonna be here for part of it. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow morning, I'll be in the sessions. And then tomorrow evening, I'm taking off my virus guy hat and putting on my Yellowstone guy hat, and I'm doing a lecture, a talk, and a book signing on this. There's a book version of my Yellowstone special issue that has just come out.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to do that. Tuesday, I'm going to try and see some scientists at MIT for molecular phylogenetics and the microbiome and horizontal gene transfer in the microbiome. Mm-hmm. That's interesting stuff.
Yes.
Eric Alm at MIT. And then I'm going to get on a plane and go back to Montana.
Sounds like a good trip.
Yeah,
it's rich and interesting.
In the end, would you like to be a scientist and not a writer?
Part of me, because I admire field biologists so much, and I admire virologists so much, and find their work fascinating and important. But I didn't take that particular fork in the road. I'm very happy to be doing what I'm doing. And I have the blessed privilege of variety. I can spend 6 years on zoonotic viruses and turn the page and say, you know, now I'm going to learn about molecular phylogenetics and Carl Woese. And this is another steep learning curve mountain to climb. So it's very challenging and scary and humbling. But boy, I have the luxury of variety.
And it's also good to get paid for it as well.
It's good to get paid for writing, yeah.
Lots of people would like to be doing that. In fact, nowadays lots of people who train as scientists decide they want to write. Do you have any advice for them, what they should do?
Don't quit your day job yet.
I think you would also say go there, right?
Go there, yeah. Go write, read great writing, and then reread it to see how it was done.
Right.
And then write.
Alan, anything left that you'd like to ask before
we
wrap up?
No, I think we covered quite a lot here.
Okay.
You guys make it fun and easy.
Well, we are interested in the subject, right?
Yeah.
And how other people communicate it. And in the end, I love viruses. I think they're the best things in the world. My license plate says viruses on my car. That says it all.
That says it all.
You can find this episode of TWIV at iTunes, of course, at microbeworld.org, and also at microbe.tv/TWIV. We love getting your questions and comments. You can send them to twiv@microbe.tv. And think about supporting all the science shows that we do at Microbe TV, not just TWIV, but TWIM, TWIP, TWIVO. We just started a This Week in Evolution. Nels Eldy is an evolutionary biologist at the University of Utah. Really interesting stuff as well. We have urban agriculture. We have Virus Watch. You can go to microbe.tv/contribute to see the different ways that you can do that. Alan Dove is usually, you can always find Alan Dove on Twitter. His blog is turbidplaque.com. Thank you for coming out today, Alan.
It's always a pleasure.
We are doing another TWIV on Tuesday with
some
of the participants in this meeting, so that should be fun as well. Our guest today has been writer David Quammen. Thank you so much for spending the time with us.
I am tickled and honored to be part of TWIV.
Great. We are too. I'm Vincent Racaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. I want to thank the American Society for Microbiology for helping make this episode happen today. And I also want to thank our producer and recorder and editor, Chris Kandayan, behind the camera. Thank
our
you very much. I also want to thank the sponsors of this show, CuriosityStream and Drobo. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWIV is viral. We're back at the NEIDL, the National Emergent. And we're back today to interview science writer David Quammen. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
It should be interesting.
Let's go.
Everything you always wanted to be. Okay. You have to do the whole thing over?